Hello all, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this video we are going to be discussing the peritoneum, which is always something that seems conceptually difficult, but as we kind of work our way through, I think you'll become more and more comfortable. So the goal of this video is not to get down into the fine details or specific mesenteries and omenta, but more to discuss what is a mesentery or what is the omentum, what even is peritoneum. So more of what these things are, so more definitions. Then we're going to do the discussions of the specific parts associated with viscera when we get to those organs. So let's start with just what is peritoneum. Peritoneum is a serous membrane lining the largest serous membrane of the body, and it lines the abdominopelvic cavity. And note that I did say pelvic cavity as well, as it does extend and end in the pelvic cavity. So we'll be talking about that peritoneum even when we move into that region of anatomy. So similar to what we had with the pleura of the thoracic cavity, there's going to be a parietal and a visceral peritoneum. Parietal peritoneum is attached to the muscular layers of the abdominal wall. So it's going to line those walls of the abdominal cavity, and it's going to be connected by extraperitoneal connective tissue. And we talked a little bit about that when we were talking about the anterior abdominal wall. Now, the visceral peritoneum is going to be firmly adhered to at least some surface or surfaces, if not all of them, of abdominal viscera. And it's going to suspend that viscera into or within that abdominal cavity region. Now, the space between the parietal and visceral peritoneum is the peritoneal cavity. This is often referred to as a potential space, and Graves is going to describe it as of capillary thinness, so you can get an idea of just how small we're talking. But it's often depicted as much, much larger in images, like the one on this previous slide here. Obviously, you're going to have viscera that's going to invaginate into this area, so the peritoneal cavity is not going to be nearly as large as what you see in illustrations. It does contain peritoneal fluid, which plays a role in lubrication to allow that mobility that you need in the viscera in this region, as well as it has some defensive properties. Now, the majority of the peritoneal cavity is referred to as the greater sac, and this is the largest portion. It's going to surround most of the abdominal and pelvic viscera. And it's a bit hard to conceptualize with any image, really, because you have to imagine the abdominal wall was also here. And so that space between the parietal peritoneum on the wall, on the abdominal wall, and the visceral peritoneum that's associated with the organs, that would be the greater sac portion of the peritoneal cavity. There's also a lesser sac, often referred to as the omental bursa, which is located posterior to the stomach and the lesser omentum. So this is your stomach, this is the lesser omentum right here. And so it's going to be located behind these structures, but anterior to the pancreas. So it's just going to be just posterior to this, and that greater and lesser sac can communicate or are connected via the epiploic or omental foramen of Winslow. So many different names associated with that connection between the greater and lesser sac. All right, let's begin to explore how this peritoneum, particularly the visceral peritoneum, can be organized into very discrete, invisible structures within the abdominopelvic cavity, and those generalized terms that are used to describe them. So we'll start with mesentery, as it's kind of the most important of these. Mesentery, just generalized, is a double layer of peritoneum that attaches intraperitoneal viscera to the posterior abdominal wall. So that is how it's going to have that connection to more retroperitoneal structures, specifically neurovasculature. So it's going to allow neurovasculature from the posterior abdominal wall to kind of move through and actually supply or drain these intraperitoneal viscera. Also, it serves as an anchoring point. Much of the abdominal viscera is intraperitoneal, and we will be using, and we will have a whole other video regarding what intraperitoneal viscera is, but in short, intraperitoneal organs are almost completely covered in visceral peritoneum. Now, mesenteries are often quite visible, and you can often very clearly see neurovasculature associated with it. These mesenteries are usually named based on their location, and most will have a meso associated with it. So you have a transverse mesocolon, which is going to be an attachment to the transverse colon, and then you have a mesoappendix that would be attached to the appendix. But if you ever hear someone referring to the mesentery, and you know this is a capital T-H-E, they are likely talking about the mesentery of the jejunum and ileum, or the majority of the small intestine. And it's named the because of its size. It is hard to miss the mesentery during a surgery or dissection. So it'd be this portion here that is connected to that small mesentery. So very large, very dominant within the abdominal cavity. Moving to the omenta. Omenta and mesentery are made of the same thing, but what is unique is that the omenta all have some form of attachment to the stomach and the proximal duodenum, or the first part of the first parts of the duodenum. All right, so therefore it is special and it gets its own name. So this is kind of the key, is that it's basically a mesentery associated with these two structures. Now let's start with the lesser omentum, which is like a mesentery in terms of it being a double layer of peritoneum. It's going to extend from the lesser curvature of the stomach. And I'm kind of putting that lesser curvature here because that's what helps me remember where it's located, but it also will extend to the proximal duodenum. So this area right here is going to be the lesser omentum. Now, once again, it can be subdivided into peritoneal ligaments, which are a different name for the same thing, just broken down into more specific parts, but does give you a better indication of location when you use these terms. So you'll have a hepatogastric, which I'm kind of outlining that portion here, and then you'll have a hepatoduodenal, all parts of the lesser omentum. So we'll come back to this term ligaments in a moment. The greater omentum has some attachment to the greater curvature of the stomach, so the larger portion of the curvature, as well as extending to the proximal duodenum. It, like the lesser omentum, is going to be further subdivided into small segments of ligaments. The most prominent of these ligaments is the gastrocolic ligament, often referred to as the omental apron. And so this right here is going to be what's referred to as the omental apron, which is a component of the gastrocolic ligament. This is gonna hang down like an apron from the greater omentum and proximal duodenum over the small intestine. So it'll actually cover this small intestine, and then it will loop back superiorly to attach to the anterior surface of the transverse colon. Thus, this portion of the greater omentum is actually four layers. Now, some people think that the omental apron is synonymous with the greater omentum, as in they're the same thing, but that's not true. It is a part of the greater omentum. There will be other ligaments associated with the greater omentum that we'll talk about in more detail as we get to those specific viscera. Now, we keep talking about those peritoneal ligaments, so let's actually define it now. Peritoneal ligaments are double layers of peritoneum that connect, and you see I have that in italics, so that's a key to understanding what a peritoneal ligament is. So it's connecting viscera with other organs or viscera to the wall. So again, same thing as a mesentery or omenta, but just a bit more specific in regards to describing what is connected. And these are typically one of those seemingly rare cases in anatomy where names are helpful. And I know it doesn't always seem like that. So these names can often be broken down to tell you exactly which organs they connect. So in the case, say, of the hepatoduodenal ligament, You have hepato, which means liver, and you have duodenal, which means duodenum. So the hepato-duodenal ligament is connecting the liver to the duodenum. And again, these ligaments are typically just subdivisions of the larger mesenteries or omenta. Lastly, I did want to review peritoneal folds, even though we have discussed them in another learning objective video. As their name would suggest, they certainly do have something to do with peritoneum. So in the case of folds, the peritoneum more covers a structure than, say, connecting them. So think putting a sheet of peritoneum over an already existing structure, and this structure will create a little bump in that sheet, and that is those peritoneal folds. So the most prominent of these, and we've talked about these, are the umbilical folds. So you have that median, medial, and lateral umbilical folds that are lying over, say, developmental structures that are occluded, or a neurovasculature in the case of the lateral umbilical fold. All right, and that brings us to our summary slide, which I know contains a bit more information than typical, but this learning objective really defines a lot of the terms that we will be using throughout the rest of our time in our discussions of gastrointestinal anatomy. Most of these terms are describing the same thing, so specific areas of peritoneum. What differs are what they connect and where they are located. So I highly advise taking some time to be comfortable with these terms, because we're going to be using them throughout the course and we'll get a bit more specific as we do. As you review, if you have any questions, always feel free to reach out with any questions, and I hope you have a great rest of your day.